So in this particular video, we'll discuss about another, class of topologies, another category of topologies, which, may fit or may rather meet some of the requirements of microinverters, right? So as the name suggests, right, we are going to talk about differential output topologies. What does it mean? It means that essentially we will have, let's say we have a DC to DC converter, right, which has an input voltage of V1. Now it can be, given a fixed duty cycle, and it can generate an output voltage, which is also a DC, which is V2, right? And also, similarly, you can have additional DC-DC converter, which you can feed the same input, and it can generate an output voltage, which is V3. Right? This is getting some duty cycle D3, this is getting some duty cycle D2. Now, instead of generating a DC output, right, and instead of giving a fixed duty cycle, let's say I vary duty cycle at 50 hertz, right? So instead of giving a fixed duty cycle, I give a fixed value or a DC value, right? Plus I give some other frequency components also. In that case, what will happen? My output voltage also will no longer be only DC, right? It will also have this other frequency component appearing in the output voltage, either directly or it's multiple or something like that, right? Depending on which topology you choose. So the idea is that if somehow, right, when we produce V2, instead of producing a DC value, if we can produce a DC and an AC riding over it, right? Similarly, V3, we again produce the same amount of DC and AC riding over it in the opposite phase, right? And if we connect our load across the output terminals of V2 and V3, right? If we connect our load at this place, right? And if we call this as the load voltage, then you can see that the load voltage is equal to V3 minus V2, right? And if you subtract V3 minus V2, the DC components will cancel out, and what we'll be left is the only AC component, right? So that is the basic principle. By using two, DC to DC converters, we are able to generate an AC output. That's the basic idea of these differential output topologies, right? Let us have now a little bit more specific example. Let us talk about, two boost converters, and let us see how exactly things work out in case of our two boost converters. So I have a common DC source, right? And there is one boost converter. Now, if you see, I have drawn boost converter, not the conventional boost converter, but I have drawn the synchronous boost converter. What is the reason for drawing synchronous boost converter is because this converter would require some time to process negative power also. And therefore, instead of drawing the conventional one where there is only switch S1 and diode D2, I have drawn the synchronous one where there is also switch S2. Right, so by doing that, we can have a bidirectional power capability. I'll come to that very soon, why we need a bidirectional power capability in such circuits. So this is one of the boost converter. Right? Let's say there is another boost converter, which is, now instead of drawing it on the left side and on the right side, I'm just, drawing it in a little different way, just below this, which is also being fed from the same supply VIN. Right, and has the same structure, same capacitance, same switches, and produces another voltage. So let's say this voltage is V1, right? And the other one is, let's say, V2 voltage, right? And the duty cycle which I'm feeding to the bottom top switch is, let's say, D1, and the duty cycle I'm feeding to the bottom second switch is D2. Now in this case, if I can, you know, since this is a boost converter, so there is a constraint, the output voltage V1 can never go below Vin, right? And therefore in this case, if I try to draw the voltages, right, and if I draw V1, I can have a DC component plus I can have an AC component above it, right, such that my minimum value should be greater than or equal to the input voltage, right? I cannot go below the input voltage. If I need more of the sinusoidal component, I can have more offset, right, and get more of the sinusoidal. For instance, if I, let's say, wanted to have more of the sinusoidal component, higher output voltage, then I can set the average value of V1 to this value and have, you know, twice the voltage as what I would have had. Similarly, V2 also, I can manipulate the second thing and I can generate this voltage V2 with the same DC offset and phase shifted or 180 degree phase shifted sinusoidal component reference. And now if I find what is the load voltage, right, let's say I connect load across this, so load is V1 minus V2, right, this is the load voltage. So the load voltage I can then draw below to the scale V load, which is 1, 2, 3, 4 steps above, right, and then so on, right? So if you see, for instance, if the input, just to give you an example, right, let's say the input voltage Vin is 12 volt, right, and then I can set V1 DC component as 24 volt, right, then I can have an riding AC over it with the V1 AC. If I see the peak value of the AC, I can have it as 24 minus 12, 12 volt. Why? Because if this is at 24 volt, this is at 12 volt, then the peak value I can have is 12 volt, right? And similarly, V2 AC peak is also 12 volt, right? If I subtract, they are out of phase, so the V load peak value is going to be 24 volt. That means the load voltage RMS you can have is 24/√2 volt. Right, so you can see that it inherently, it can do a boost operation, right? And this boost operation is important because we are talking about solar inverters, so we want to, you know, use the single panel. You're talking about micro inverter, you want to have single panel and boost the output voltage. Now one thing this particular circuit lacks is, obviously, you cannot have boost, which is a very large value, right? And so this circuit may not necessarily be suitable for a microinverter application, right? You can boost 2 times, 3 times, 4 times. But as we have seen, the microinverters required a boostage of as high as, you know, 10 times or more, for which these normal boost converters may not be good enough, right? They either may not operate at all, right? And maybe limited total gain. Even if, you know, they operate, the overall efficiency is going to be very poor. So therefore we don't use the normal boost, but we can use some other circuit, but in general with the same principle. Let's, before looking at other, you know, other similar circuits, let's talk about another small point here, which is the why I drawn these circuits to be bidirectional. So let us have a look at it. Now let's say this output terminals which are coming from V1 and the other terminal coming from V2, now this is connected to the grid. How will it connect to the grid? Let's say we have an inductor and then I have a grid. Now if this is connected to the grid, there is this current which is flowing and there is this voltage V12, Now this current is also sinusoid. This V12 is also sinusoid, right? And let's assume that the phase between the I grid and V12 is almost same. In that case, how would I12 look like? I12 would look same as the VL or V12. Right, the magnitude is different, the shape is the same. So what does it say? It says that the total output power at any instant, right, power going to the grid, let me use this space. So P grid, what is P grid at any instant as a function of time? It is I grid, right? This is I grid, the one which I have drawn here, I grid multiplied by V load or V12. So if I grid is I sine of omega t and V load is V sine omega t, right, then this becomes VI sine square omega t. If you see this expression is never positive, never negative, right? Although as we have seen before, this expression can be further divided into two expressions, one pure DC component, another oscillatory component. But irrespective of that, the power never flows back. Power is always going out. It goes from 0 to V into I and then again comes back to 0 and it repeats this process. But power is always flowing in left to right. Now you focus, how is power flowing within these two converters? So if I try to write the expression for power supplied by converter 1, what is power supplied by converter 1? It is the output voltage of that converter, which is V1, multiplied by the current that is supplied by the converter 1. And the current supplied by converter 1 is nothing but same as the current flowing in the grid. So I can write this as V1 into I grid. Right, now what is V1? V1, as we understand, right, if you want the total load voltage to be AC, V1 will have both, it will have a DC component as well as AC component. So what is V1? V1 is VDC, which is DC component in the output voltage, plus the V. So if the total output voltage is V sine omega t, one converter is producing half of it, V sine omega t by 2. This is the voltage V1 into the grid current, which is I sine omega t. If you expand it, what will you get? You get VDC into I sine omega t plus V into I by 2 sine omega t, sine square omega t. What does it say? It says that there is a possibility, or rather the power will be bidirectional in nature. So sometimes P1 of t will be positive, sometimes P1 of t will be negative. Right, you still have the sine square omega t expression, but you also have sine of omega t expression, right? And what does it say? It says that this expression can become negative, and which makes sense, because if you see, the converter output voltage is always positive, right? It is oscillating, but it is always positive. But the converter current is going positive and negative. And therefore, if you multiply these two, in this expression, you get power greater than zero because both voltage and current are positive, right? So this is the voltage, this is VDC offset, right? But the current has no offset here. But in this other second period, you see current is negative, but the voltage is still positive, so power is less than zero. So what is happening essentially? Where is this negative power coming from? The negative power is actually coming from the bottom converter. Why? Because on the grid there is always positive power. Grid is never, you're not absorbing any power from the grid. So essentially what is happening is, for some duration, the top converter will give power and bottom will absorb little bit of power, and the net power will flow into the grid. And for the other duration, the top will absorb power and the bottom will give more power than what is required by the grid to compensate for this power coming back from the top converter. So at any instant, if you see, there is some power which is really going into the load, but some of the power is just oscillating between these two converters, right? And to feed X amount of power, a converter has to actually process much more than X power, because it has to feed more power, then it is also absorbing more power and so on, right? So the total power, in a way, you can imagine that some amount of power is, you know, just circulating in this loop, and not really going to the load. And that is the wastage, right? So the overall utilization in terms of the components and so on is not that great in this circuit. That's also, again, you know, one limitation of such circuit. But that said, if you do not have bidirectional converters, this will not, you know, work as we are thinking of it. And therefore, the need for bidirectional converter is mandatory for such circuits to operate. So need bidirectional power flow capability, right? So you need circuits which have bidirectional power flow capabilities to do the above. Next step. Now, once, let me copy the circuit from the top. So that then we can further discuss about this circuit. The next thing is, now how does, if for the time being, if we only, you know, let's say focus on one of the converter, then how does this converter behave? Is the volt second still applicable? If it is applicable, is there a relationship between the output voltage V1 and D1 and so on, right? Now, since we are talking about synchronous converter, that means they are always in continuous conduction mode, right? Because if the current becomes zero, then the top switch is on and the current will start flowing in the reverse, right? So a synchronous converter always operates in continuous conduction mode. Plus, let's assume everything else to be ideal. Assume all components to be ideal. Now, if we apply volt second balance, right, we understand we want the output voltage to be equal to a DC component plus an AC component, right? And our input voltage is Vin. So if we want this output voltage and with this input voltage, can we use this? Because we know for a boost converter with these assumptions, right, the output voltage upon the input voltage is given by 1 upon 1 minus D. And therefore, can I say that if I keep duty cycle as this VDC plus V by 2 sine omega T and the input is V in, right? If I use this equation 1 and try to find the duty cycle, will I be able to achieve the desired output voltage? Or in other words, would this expression still be true if in the output we do no longer have only DC but we have AC component also? Will this, by solving this, will I get D as a function of time such that I can feed that D and generate that output voltage? The answer is both yes and no, right? So this expression is valid if we take certain assumptions, right? What are those assumptions? Let's have a look at it. Let's apply the basic principle, the volt second balance, right? So if we apply volt second balance, if I take the inductor current IL, right? Inductor current goes up when S1 is on and inductor current comes down when S1 is off. Now, if my initial point and the final point is the same, right? Then I know that if I apply the input voltage for D duration, D1 in this case, and I and the inductor sees a voltage of V in minus V out for 1 minus D duration, then I can just say that D1 into V in plus 1 minus D1 into V in minus VO is equal to 0, which gives me this expression, right? But what is required for this expression is the initial point and the final point of the current must be same. But if the initial point and the final point of the current is same, that means all the cycles are like that. Right? That means the average component or the average DC current is constant, or there is a flat DC average current, right? But that is not possible, because if, for example, this converter, you see, if I equate the input power with the output power, right? Output power I have already derived in the top. Let me borrow that expression from there. So the output power was a function of sine as well as sine square, right? So the output power was something into sine of omega t plus something into sine square of omega t, right? Sine square of omega t, I can always represent it as summation of something constant plus cos of 2 omega t, right? So let me, instead of saying this, let me say plus something plus another term, which is cos of 2 omega t. So that means the output power has 50 hertz component, 100 hertz component, and a DC component. And therefore, if the input power is same as output power, assuming not much of an energy storage, then the input power will also have these three components. Now, the input voltage Vin is constant. And therefore, what about IL or the input current? The input current from the top converter, right, Iin1, which is the input current of the top converter, is going to be equal to Pin upon Vin. Now, Vin being constant, it will still have 50 hertz. It will have DC component plus it will have 100 hertz component. That means inductor current is no longer going to be only DC. It will have 50 as well as 100 hertz. But if we take the assumption that the starting and the ending points are same for all of them, then in a way we are implying that it has only DC. So our assumption that the starting point and the ending point in the current is same is wrong. If that assumption is wrong, we can no longer write this volt second balance here, right? And therefore this expression no longer holds good for such operation. Okay, now yeah, we have certainly shown that this is, you know, no longer true, right? We cannot use equation 1 and then try to find out what is d of t, and then if we feed that d of t, you know, we will get an output voltage which is vdc plus v by 2 sin omega t. So then how do you find d? How do you find d which actually gives you this output, because you still want this output, right? So how do you find d which gives you this output? So let us have a look at this circuit in a little bit different way. Let me draw the circuit again. This is Vn. This is the circuit, right? This is V1. I'm just focusing on the top converter, right? Because whatever we do is applicable then for both. So I can, you know, show this in the equivalent circuit as this. This is Vin, this is inductor. What about this voltage? Let me call it V alpha, right? I can say that the average value of V alpha over a switching period is nothing but when switch S1 is on, right? This is duty cycle D1, it is 0. So D1 times 0 plus 1 minus D1 times V1. Right, that is the average voltage at node V alpha averaged over a switching period. So this is nothing but 1 minus D1 times V1. So on the right hand side, what is this voltage? This voltage is V alpha. And this is the equivalent circuit of this left side boost converter. So far so good. Yeah. So now usually what happens? V1 is DC, right? Usually V1 and D1 both are DC constant values, right? If that is the case, you can understand V alpha is also a DC constant value. And then this whole circuit is DC. So you have the input voltage as DC, you have an inductor, your output voltage V alpha is also a DC. Right, and thus now if you write KVL in this equation, you say that the inductor DC drop is zero, and thus VDC is equal to Vin, and that is, you know, again gives back you the same expression which you get from volt second, but no longer here, right? Here these assumptions are not valid. So let us see how you want to find or solve for this circuit here. One way to do it is you still keep the same circuit, V in, right? We have got an expression for I in. This is an inductor L, right? And here you have a voltage which is V alpha, right? Which is, so this I in, as we understand, has a DC component plus a 50 Hertz component plus a 100 Hertz component. V alpha, as we understand, is equal to 1 minus D1 times V1, where V1 itself has a DC component and a 50 Hertz component. Now the only thing is we can solve this circuit and we can find the expression for D1. Looking at it, you can quickly realize, right, that if you just have DC component in D1, then the KVL will not satisfy, because V in is only DC. V alpha will have DC plus 50 Hertz, but the current has 100 Hertz. So how would the voltage of the 100 Hertz will become zero while traveling this loop if you write the loop equation. So therefore you can quickly see that D1 has to have a DC component plus 50 Hertz component at least, because this 50 getting multiplied by this 50 will give us a 100 Hertz component. So that's it. So you can say that D1 is, let's say, equal to capital D1 plus D11 sine of omega t plus delta, right? And now you can substitute this D1 into the top expression. You can write KVL equations. You can use superposition. So you can solve this circuit three times for DC, for 50 Hertz and for 100 Hertz. And you can find the expression for D1 by doing that, which will give you the output desired voltage, right, as required in this particular example. Interestingly, you can see that once you try to find the DC equivalent circuit, right, if you're using superposition, right, so you find DC equivalent circuit, find the DC current and DC voltages, then find the 100 Hertz and then find 50 Hertz and so on. So if you find DC, then how will it look like? It will look V in, right? There'll be an inductor in DC that will be short circuited. Right, so there is no DC drop here across this inductor, right? There is an inductor, but there is no DC drop. On the right hand side in V alpha, right, if you want to find the DC component, you can see that it would be nothing but the DC component in V alpha, right? And what is the DC component in V alpha? You can substitute this value of D1 here, right, and then try to expand on it, so you will get DC component of V alpha. And since the current is zero, so V in becomes equal to this DC component of V alpha, right? Similarly, you can solve the other two equations, and the L effect will be there, right? Here there is no L effect because we are talking about DC. If you talk about 50 Hertz, then L will have an effect, 100 Hertz L will have an effect, and so on. And once you get all the three by writing equation for all the three subsystems, then you can solve for D1. You may require higher frequencies also as a solution, but you can try that out. So yeah, so in general, right, if the in converters and output voltages are not DC, you cannot have volt second balance applied to each cycle. Right, you can apply it for the full fundamental cycle, because at the start of the current at one cycle and the start of the current at the next fundamental cycles are going to be equal, but not for each switching cycle. But let's say if you still want to apply, right, essentially what are you trying to do? You are trying to say that this neglect this inductor drop. That's what you are trying to say indirectly. Neglect the L drop, because if you neglect the L drop, V in becomes equal to V alpha, which is 1 minus D1 times V1, and therefore output by input voltage becomes equal to 1 upon 1 minus D, which is the conventional boost converter formula. So if you are trying to use that formula, indirectly you are trying to say that, look, I am neglecting this inductor, or rather I am neglecting this voltage drop across inductor, right? That is what indirectly one is trying to say. So if we are neglecting the voltage drop across inductor, what does it mean? So if U by V in is equal to 1 minus 1 minus D, 1 upon 1 minus D is being used, that implies that we are neglecting the voltage drop across inductor. And what does that mean? That implies two things. One is the L very small, right? So if your L is very small, then this may be okay. Second is your current I in is small. Third is omega is small. When I say omega is small, because the impedance is nothing but j omega L of an inductor. So if omega is small, still the impedance is small and the voltage drop is going to be small. Right. So with these three conditions, usually if you neglect it, right, then you can see what happens to the voltage drop across the inductor as compared to those harmonic frequencies in V alpha. Right. And if the voltage drop across the inductor as compared to V alpha is much, much smaller, then probably, yes, we can neglect the voltage drop across the inductor, and we can then probably use this formula as an assumption. But in general, it's not, 100% accurate. It's not always true. Now, as I discussed to you just some time back, right, that this kind of circuit, which we have drawn using, two boost converters, will have limited gain. It cannot give you a very large gain. So if you want to use 30 volt panel and you want to generate 230 volt AC output, which is 325 volt peak, such circuit is not possible. It can do, 2, 3, 4 times of gain, but not 10 times of gain. But then going with the same philosophy, what we can then do is, instead of using the conventional boost converters, we can use something called as flyback converters, right? Or bidirectional flyback converter, which may look something like this. So now again, say we have an AC source Vin, right? On one side of the AC source, I connect a flyback. And generate an output, right? This is a flyback circuit. So I have Vin, I have V1. Right, where this is a transformer. Now, if I want to make this bidirectional, what can I do? Right, I can connect a switch across the other diode, right, and I can connect a diode on this primary side, right, that will make it bidirectional. How will it make bidirectional? Because let's say if the current now wants to reverse, right, so current wants to flow in this direction, so you turn on this switch. Right. Once you turn on the switch, this current can flow here, it will leave the dot. So simultaneously, when this switch turns off, the current can leave the dot here, right? And thus it can flow through this diode. So this is nothing but a bidirectional flyback. Because we have already discussed that for such circuits to work, we need to have a bidirectional circuit. So this is one circuit, right? Similarly, we can draw another circuit here with another transformer. With the output, right? We call it V2. And again, as we have done before, the differential we can, call it as V load, which is V1 minus V2. You can do same things, right? We can control each of them to produce a DC output plus an AC output, such that the DC output of both the outputs gets cancelled out and does not appear in the load voltage, and the AC output, gets twice and appears in the load voltage as two times the AC output of individual converters. Right? Whatever we discussed in terms of circulating power is still applicable, right? The only one limitation of the previous circuit which we have addressed is the higher gain. So we can achieve high gain here, right? But then circulating power is still an issue. It's still an issue, right, which we need to somehow address. And if you see, that is still a problem. The other thing which is also addressed is because there's an isolation in this flyback circuit, right? So the leakage current problem can also be addressed, which is okay. So the key thing which is still a problem in this circuit is the circulating power, you know, which increases the losses, which requires components to be overrated, because now you are not only handling power in the one direction, but you are also handling excess power to be supported by the other converter, right? And therefore you need your converter components, being in a transformer, being an inductor, being switch, being a diode. You have to, you know, use overrated devices for the circuit to operate, and thus these are not really, you know, very popular when we talk about micro inverters. Although they are a potential candidate, they are potential category of circuits, they are not something which is very, very popular in practical implementations of micro inverters. So moving on, in the next lecture, right, in the next video, we will talk about one of the more practical circuits, or one of the more practical approach which is being followed in micro inverters, which is a single stage conversion, right? which utilizes a single converter, which is a single stage conversion, and at the same time provides high gain as well as isolation.